Welcome to A Little Bit Racey, the improvisation comedy panel show that you just couldn't make up. I'm James Cottle, and I'm here to say I'm no good at rhyming, so here are the rules. In the show, panelists race against a time limit of just 3 minutes to improvise their way to a destination. They begin from different starting points and use an assortment of randomly assigned objects, companions, and modes of transport, but they must keep all of them with them when they travel. However, they also have to overcome another panelist who will improvise obstacles to try and stop them. Tonight, four will enter, four will leave, thanks to our vastly improved fire escape procedures. Please welcome Pip Mason, Chella, Quint, David, Anik, and Tom Harrison. And welcome specifically to the stage, Pip Mason and Chella, Quint. Lovely stuff. So let's see what the challenge is in round one. Twisty French weirdos Cirque Du Soleil are wowing audiences all over the world in a recent sellout tour. It's spectacular. That is, until a show in Oslo where the performers proceed to hold their entire audience at sword point, demanding their worldly possessions. You probably have about 3 minutes before they complete their convoluted robbery dance and leave the polite Nordics penniless. Head to the Norwegian National Theatre, save the audience, and put a stop to these flexible felons. So, attempting the challenge first will be Pip. Your object tonight is a tutu. Your companion is King Olaf of Sweden. Your mode of transport is a hoverboard, powered by farts. And your starting point is mud wrestling Martin Clunes for loose change in Tokyo, Japan. So, best of luck to you trying to get to Norway, and best of luck to you, Chella, throwing whatever obstacle you can in his way. Pip, your time starts now.
Now, it is a little-known fact in international relations that most agreements can be solved between nations via the medium of mud wrestling. I am Sweden's representative, a country that I have no ties to. In terms of family or relations, and randomly Japan is represented by Martin Clunes. We're both wearing our ceremonial tutus as tradition demands, and after a grueling battle I drown him in a pool of mud for the change in his pocket, because the tutu has pockets, and secure international trading rights for the next 50 years. Go me.
Well played.
Thank you.
Wait a minute, what colour are the tutus?
Pink. Right, and but the King of Sweden, Olaf, my good buddy, says, there's a situation in Norway. They're like our neighbours. We kind of have to help out. You know, it's more of a, you know, we help you, we help me situation. Yeah, so, yeah.
Historically, that's not accurate.
Olaf doesn't care about history. He just cares about getting maybe free tickets to Cirque du Soleil. So, okay. So right, we grab the only mode of transport available, which is a hoverboard powered by farts. It's from one of those vending machines next to the, like, where you can get schoolgirl panties in Japan, which I know nothing about. It has enough power in it to get us across the sea, maybe to the coast of China.
Wait. Where's this power coming from?
Do you really want me to describe in detail where the power is coming from?
Yes.
It may have something to do with the Kanto bean sauce I had earlier and a placed tube somewhere. It's okay, me and Olaf take turns. It's okay. I'm equal in his eyes. He is royalty, but, you know, he's just a bloke. He's fine. So we power ourselves across the sea to the coast of China. We make our way across the Northern Territories. Make our way to what is next to there?
The Northern Territories are in Canada.
There's Northern Territories in China as well.
Okay.
Right, and we make it to Kazakhstan.
Beautiful.
Now, Kazakhstan is a bit mountainous, a bit hilly. We're going to have to try a little bit harder to get the power to go through that, so maybe pick up some nice lentil bean soup on the way through China just for Kazakhstan, so we can power our way over the mountains. My tutu is, you know, causing a bit of drag. But, you know, ceremony demands it, really. So it's part and parcel, unless somebody wants to throw up an obstacle.
I'm just enjoying the pun there. I was appreciating that. I feel like through the power of puns, you could go further. I can't even stop you.
Oh, okay.
I would suggest.
Okay, right.
No, wait a minute. I suggest, actually, that you both fart at the same time. because that will exponentially increase your power.
Thank you.
Thank you for helping me.
No, don't do that. We go through Kazakhstan, and then next to that is Ukraine.
Sort of, yes.
We go through. It's a big fart, okay? We just power through the stratosphere. If anything, I'm using the 2-2 to get a bit of loft. It's fine. I get to Ukraine. Next to Ukraine is Poland over a bit of Russia.
Yeah, it's a little bit.
It goes down. We go to Poland. We power way through that. Maybe a bit of trouble on the way.
I think you've doubled back on yourself, and it's taking twice as long now.
It's King Olaf. He wants the scenic route. It's fine. he gets us through most diplomatic relations because he's a king. And then there's a bit of water. There's a bit of water. Oh my God, this is going to take some proper doing. Okay, so
10 seconds left!
Oh my God, we eat something that makes us fart a whole lot, and despite risking prolapse, we make it all the way across.
Hit Mason!
I make it to Denmark! Yes!
Just think about what you clapped for. So now attempting the challenge will be Chella. Your object tonight is a bag of spanners. Your companion is the Uber chicken. Your mode of transport is a penny farthing, and your starting point is battling leprechauns at the end of a rainbow in Bogota, Colombia. So, best of luck to you trying to get all the way to Norway. Your time starts now.
Thank you. Well, I am a really big fan of cycling, and penny farthings are my favorite kind of retro bicycle. So the bike and I, and the Uber chicken, of course, we haul the bag of spanners onto my back, some sort of weird modern hipster Father Christmas scenario, and we cycle north. We get as far as the Mexican border, and I unpack the spanners and start dismantling the wall that Donald Trump will have inevitably started to build by the time this airs. I dismantle the wall, the Uber chicken helps, we fly over, him squawking, her squawking all the way.
Well, how does the Uber chicken work? He doesn't have any hands of which to apply manual labor using...
I'm just going to say she. Just going to say she. She clucks for everybody. And she will cluck you up. Are you satisfied with that answer?
Yeah, sure.
Good! Okay! We keep going. We go further north. We go up the east coast of the United States. Everybody's really intrigued by my bicycle because they've never seen one before because they only have giant cars. I keep some of the leprechaun gold and I pay my way through the southern states because they've never met anyone like me before. And and the Uber chicken helps by laying golden eggs, and I sell them and I give them away to poor children on the route. And we get to Washington, D.C. And
well, I was about to say, you make it through the southern states and several angry cooks want to make some fried chicken out of it and offer to pay you for the chicken.
The chicken's not for sale. The chicken is not for sale because... only with the chicken's feathers, which are waterproofed, will I be able to get across the sea. I've got to get across the Atlantic Ocean when we get to the Northeast.
This is the Uber chicken.
The Uber chicken is part duck. And the Uber folks, part duck, and helps me to create a raft out of my penny farthing turned on its side and covered in feathers. And I'm able to paddle my way using the spanners across the Atlantic Ocean. I get up to the channel. I get to the North Sea. And
1 minute left.
Unfortunately, a last ditch thing. Several of your spanners are just falling out of your bag and they're sinking to the bottom of the ocean. If you don't retrieve them, you're not going to have all of your spanners.
I have to keep all the spanners.
You've got to keep all of them with you. That's
all your
of the
items
game.
With you.
Luckily, the Uber chicken has a stealth mode, and the stealth mode takes her under the sea's surface. We get down on submarine levels. We're right down. We're in the abyss. We are in the abyss. We retrieve the spanners. We pick them up. We come back. We're near Dover, and we keep going. We keep gliding along. And we start seeing fjords. We know that we're getting close.
you're nearly there, but unfortunately the seawater is just making the penny farthing wheels just seize up. Oh no, if only you had some sort of tool to fix that.
Luckily, all the spanners save the day and I'm able to fix everything.
10 seconds left!
And and we get onto the shore just in time and we get in and we get to the theater and luckily everyone is saved.
Hey! Hey. Excellent stuff. Now, the interesting part. We have to choose a winner from this pair, so we're going to do it by way of applause. If you think that Pip deserves to win this round. Please give him a big round of applause.
I thought he was great.
Yeah, yeah, sportsmanlike conduct. Yeah. I like it. Okay, and if you
sportswomanlike conduct. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, equal opportunities. Yes. And if you believe that Chella deserves to win, then give her a round of applause. Pip again. Chella again. I'm going to say Chella. That was tight, though. So congratulations to our first pair. You may leave the stage. Now, please. Thanks very much. Now, we're going to be joined by our second pair. Please welcome to the stage David Anik and Tom Harrison. So, welcome to the stage. Attempting the challenge first will be David. Your object tonight is a Lego brick. Your companion is Winston Churchill. Your mode of transport is moon shoes. And your starting point is disagreeing with your grandma about which Call of Duty game is best. In Cape Town, South Africa. So best of luck to you getting to Norway, and best of luck to Tom trying to stop him. Dave, your time starts now.
Okay. This is deeper than most of them I've ever had. Right, okay. First off, Grandma, it's Black Ops 2. That conversation ends pretty swiftly. We leave the house. Right, you know it. We leave the house. Churchill is with me, smoking like a beast. I love the guy. Just giving it that to everyone. Everyone loves him. He's the only conservative everyone really gets behind. He had an easy ride of it. I've got the Lego brick in my pocket for, you know, no reason. Now, moon boots, I'm assuming they're either bouncy or made of rock. We're going to go with bouncy, it helps me. So, we just bounce up straight through Africa, making our way towards the Congo.
Churchill's fresh out of stogies, you've got to stop and get him some more. He's going to be like, you know, he's going to get twitchy soon.
All right, I really don't know where to buy cigars in the Congo. Okay. I. Do you know what? I'm going to walk into a shop. I'm going to play this pretty simple. I walk in. I'm like, look at that man. He's doing this. They know to fill his fingers. They do so. Right, that was, come on. That was clever. Anyway, the cigar in back up and we're still on it. We're moon booting away. I'm going to give Churchill one of the moon boots and we'll both hop. That way we're on the same sort of level. And yeah, we keep plowing it through. We'll get up to about Egypt.
Where Churchill steps on a Lego piece and you can't speech your way out of that level of pain.
You used my weapon against me. Yeah. Oh no, Churchill. Right, in which case I now give him... Oh, do you know what? In my head he stepped on it with not his moon boot shoe. That's so unfortunate.
Yeah, that's way better
that
for me.
That is way worse, yeah. I give him the other moon boot. No, I just get him to swap shoes. clearly one of his feet is now fine, so we'll just continue bouncing on. The Lego's back in my pocket. Why did he even take it out to put it on the floor in front of him?
He wanted to try and build a model Spitfire, but then he realised there was only one bit.
He's got a terrible imagination.
I'm very pro canon on this show. I'll just fill in the gaps of other people's stuff.
I wish I could build a Spitfire too. I'd ride in the thing towards. Either way, I've got no problem. We're still hopping, moon booting towards it. We're going to make it.
1 minute left.
One of your moon boots reverses its polarity and starts sucking you into the ground.
Thank you. Okay. I take my foot out of it. He takes his foot out of it. Right, we start really heavily carrying them. Churchill, using his general orator skills, convinces everyone in, where would we be about now? Like Romania or something?
Yeah, sure.
We're about Romania. Gets all the Romanians on board and they like help us carry these really heavy moon boots.
I like to imagine they're carrying him like the bit in Spider-Man where he loses the mask and they're all just carrying him down the subway. He's just like, this will be a glorious day.
He doesn't even care anymore.
He's just...
I'm just like, Churchill, good on you, mate. Holding the Lego brick going... No one's going to stop him.
They put his bowler hat on like they do the mask in the film.
10 seconds left.
There's nothing to say. I'm riding Romanian smoking cigars with Churchill. And we just... We get there and kill a bunch of clowns together.
Amazing! Give it up! I think you just won everything. Now Tom will be attempting the challenge. Your object is a magic finger.
It is.
Your companion is your own perfect cousin.
Oh, I hate that guy.
Your mode of transport is the soul train. And your starting point is wearing the wrong gang colours at a brownies meeting in Sydney's Australia.
Oh, no.
So best of luck to you, Tom, trying to get to Norway, and best of luck to you, Dave, trying to stop him. Tom, your time starts now.
Okay, so I'm at this brownies meeting wearing the green gang colours of the 49th Street Girl Guide. And this is a real dangerous situation to be in, so I think I'm going to have to use my magic finger to dye... This is going to really break the game, it's going to be great. To dye my clothes red, the same colour as the brownie street killers. So that I can slip out unnoticed and hop into my soul train, which is conveniently waiting at a nearby train station.
Unfortunately, the train cannot move forward because it is powered by souls and currently empty.
Well, I'm just about the least... Oh, it's a soul, that kind of soul train. I had a whole Chaz and Dave inspired bit that... no, that's fine, we'll improv around it, that's what we're here for. I use the magic finger to attract people as like a...
No, wait there. The magic finger we've set up only changes the colours of things.
Okay. I can do this. I sell myself as the great materialismo who can change the material of your clothes. And it's like... It would be magic happening in front of someone. I think that would impress someone enough to like get on a train with me. Maybe. We'll say that it does. And this... jets the soul train off, and I go zooming. I'm on an island. Oh, God.
keep going.
Oh, no. Okay. I get to a dock where I offer to... Oh, I'm sinking. Well, I'm not sinking because I'm not on a boat. I get to a dock where I attach floats. I pay my way by changing the... you've really sunk me with this, James, because I'm a little bit more than just changing colours.
You have your perfect cousin. He could do a lot of things.
Oh, my perfect cousin. I forgot about this. My perfect cousin is such a smooth talker that we managed to buy spare bits of jetty that we attached. Crossing the seas is hard. We use that to rig up a raft that I then float out on. It's kind of like Life of Pi, but... you know, less tigers and more annoying cousins. And we wash up in Indonesia.
Wait,
where
have you brought the train with you? Because you
no,
have
I'm
to.
I'm floating on it.
Oh,
I'm
right.
Into
sorry,
a rock, no. You idiot. And I wash ashore in Indonesia where I make a living conning backpackers by changing the colour of their clothes and being like, dude, bad acid, like, oh, you have not changed, you know, you have not changed the colour of your clothes, you're just freaking out, man. And then while they're distracted, I steal their money. And I'm only in my first place. So I backpack my way, pulling the train behind me, which the souls have jumped off because it was starting to get a little bit kidnappy. And I just don't want to give you that ammunition. And yeah, I push the train. Maybe I get one of those wacky cart things. Maybe I'm operating it with my perfect cousin. He needs to start pulling his weight. From there, I manage to cross the border over into China, where an obstacle
your cousin,
happened.
Your cousin is so perfect that he is just absolutely frustrating you all of the way by suggesting things you could be doing a tiny bit better.
God damn you, Darren, for what... Okay. Well, I do what I always do to awkward situations with my family, and I just bottle it up into a tiny, tiny ball that's going to, you know, probably be released in some horrific episode later. But we'll ignore that for now. And me and Darren, arm in arm, using our stupid cart thing, push our way.
You have 10 seconds left.
Well, I'm done. screw you, Darren. This is all your fault.
Tom Harrison. Wonderful asterisk. So, now we get to choose who has won out of these two. So I'm going to ask for some cheers. If you think that Dave wins, cheer now. He didn't get there. And if you think that Tom wins, cheer now. Dave again. Tom.
Oh, right.
It goes to David Alnwick. Congratulations. You may leave the stage. Thank you very much, guys. So, now we are moving swiftly on to round two. So, in this round, the winning panelists must try and reach a whole new destination. They may use their object, mode of transport, and companion again, but this time they are allowed to dispose of them if they wish. However, the defeated panelists will try and stop them once again, this time using their own object, companion, and mode of transport to improvise obstacles in order to prevent them from becoming the a little bit racy Cirque du Soleil. In order to prevent them from becoming the a little bit racy Cirque du Soleil sore point stick up savior. Sick. So let's see what the challenge is in round two. You storm into the theater and save the audience, putting a stop to the robbery by kicking several poles out from beneath the balancing act. But just as you think the job is done, the manager rushes up to you in protest. Turns out you've made a terrible mistake. The robbery was all just part of the act, and the audience were in no danger at all. What's more, the manager now has no show, as the entire Cirque du Soleil company is already being carted off by the police. Whew. Feeling responsible, you pledge to stand in for them at the next date on the tour, which is unfortunately on a luxury cruise ship in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. Hurry there and put on a freaky show. So, attempting the challenge first will be Chella. So welcome back to the stage, Chella and Pip! So, Chella, just to remind everyone, you have with you your bag of spanners, your yes. Uber chicken, and your penny farthing.
Oh my
but
God.
Now Pip will be trying to stop you using his tutu, his King Olaf of Sweden, and his hoverboard powered by farts. So, best of luck to you trying to get to the cruise ship in the Pacific. Your time starts now.
Well, the Uber chicken and I have bonded, and we're very close now. We feel really bad about the incident with the audience, but we are going to save them on that cruise ship. We realize that if I fly on her back, carrying the spanners and hoisting the bicycle behind me, we might be able to cross the international dateline and save time.
Yeah, that sounds like it all checks out, logically.
It would check out.
Oh?
If only, ahead of you, flying in midair, just blowing his gasket, is King Olaf, just blowing away on his hoverboard powered by farts, and he's just heading straight to you like a ballistic missile.
Well, we try and duck, but we get covered in tutu. And Olaf. But I'm able to save the tutu and put it on myself and disguise myself as one of the other cruise ship acts for later in this story.
Oh, that'll be very useful.
In the meantime, we've got Olaf on the chicken with me, and I'm carrying the bicycle. I realized that Olaf can probably use it as a raft like I did.
Wait, why has Olaf joined you?
He hasn't for long. I drop him and the bicycle into the sea. And
oh,
off
wow.
they go, and they're over the fjords, and I try and get across Russia and China using the golden eggs because they've decided to use those as currency instead of the U.S. dollar now. We get to the edge of the China Sea, and we realize that we've got no more transport. So I use the eggs to buy a rickshaw in
Very nice.
China. Yeah. Which also is not going to get me across the sea.
Unfortunately, just as the chicken is about to sound the rickshaw, I rugby tackle him from behind. I'm covered in discarded tutu and Martin Clunes' blood. I can take on the Uber chicken. Thank you.
You keep misgendering the Uber chicken. But moving on, I put on that tutu as well because tutus is all you... Tutus is all you need to get across the sea. I float like an anemone. I disguise myself as part of the coral reef as we get past Australia. And we head toward Micronesia. We go toward Palau. And eventually...
And as you're swimming along, Count Olaf bursts out of the ocean like Jason from Friday the 13th, part one. His prolapse has just overtaken him, and he is now like a zombie thing, and he is just tackling you to the ground, dragging you underneath the waves.
At which point I start hitting him with my spanners. Spanner after spanner after spanner, and zombie King Olaf descends back into the sea.
At least now he can become the king of the crabs or something.
So...
Whoa, yeah, yeah.
Yes.
As he's the king of the crabs now, he... He has his minions help me across the sea.
1 minute left.
The crabs.
Why is he helping you? He's my friend.
But the crabs were my friends first because they knew the Uber chicken. And peace has been arranged by the Uber chicken under the sea.
I killed the Uber chicken with my bare hands.
Did he?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Sorry.
I mourn the Uber chicken. But I don't let it deter me for too long. I get to Easter Island and I create a ceremony in honor of the Uber chicken.
It's beautiful. It really is.
And then I go on my own. I swim. I swim those last few thousand miles. And I would swim 500 more because I want to do it in the Uber chicken's memory now. I want to save those Cirque du Soleil people and I want to get on that cruise ship in my two tutus.
You have 10 seconds left. And put on that show.
In those last 10 seconds, I put on the show to end all shows. My pink tutus flapping in the breeze. My memories of the Uber chicken. My bruises from the spanners. The weird bubbling approval of King Olaf. And I save the day.
Hey, Chella Quint. That was surprisingly touching. Yeah. All right. Fantastic stuff from our first pair there in round one. Now it's time for our second pair to attempt the challenge. So let's welcome the second pair to the stage. Please welcome Dave Anik and Tom Harrison. So now attempting the challenge of getting to the cruise ship is David Anik. You have with you your Lego brick, Winston Churchill, and your moon shoes, and some Romanians apparently. And now Tom will be trying to stop you using his magic finger, his own perfect cousin, and his soul train. So, best of luck to you, Mr. Anik. Trying to get to the Pacific Ocean. Your time starts now.
Okay, so straight away, we're going to take a right.
Yeah.
Towards Greenland, Candaway, and moon shoes, little known fact, float. So, yep. I essentially Jesus straight over that water. do a Jesus.
And, pulling carry, a Jesus.
Carrying Winston Churchill on my shoulders. Wait there, switch that around. He's carrying me on my shoulders. I'm no fool. He'll weigh me down, won't he? I'll drown.
The thing is, you know what else floats? A soul train when I make up a stupid reason that it floats. And now, this train is full of souls because I've been using it as a replacement service in the UK. Aren't I funny? So, we're just barreling down on you with my perfect cousin giving me tips on doing Pilates and just generally being real, real obnoxious. But I'm ignoring it once again. Bottle the feelings down.
Okay, well, I keep bombing across the ocean as fast as I can possibly get. And eventually I get to the coast of Greenland and Winston turns around and goes, "We will fight them on the beaches."
I'm just awestruck. This is basically like seeing Gallagher smash a melon. You know, this is what everyone's come here to see, Churchill say that. I'm like, yeah. Fair enough. Keep going.
Give that exact speech to all of the Romanians. They can't help but rally. I salute him one last time as I moon boot away and watch the carnage ensue between him and a train. And then I plow across Greenland, which I assume is, fields and shit. And then I cut that out. Sorry. Didn't mean to swear. And then carry on. Do I have absolutely anything else to help me? Lego brick. No, we're just going to keep going across Greenland in those moon boots.
Once you get there, I use my magic finger, which you so potently nerfed, to turn all of your clothes red. And little do you know that Greenland's one and only zoo has just had a massive escape from its bull enclosure. Because I have to use this for something.
Okay. I could have been wearing this colour, it's my hair that would have got me, right? The bulls are stampeding towards me, I look at them in total fear, and then remember my final weapon, throw the Lego on the floor, and watch the chaos ensue. Have you ever heard a bull scream? That's all that happens. Horns and hooves everywhere.
Stop picture it and go!
And then I keep going. And these moon boots, which have easily been the most useful and arguably the only thing I apparently needed, get me across to the other side of Canada, and I continue across the water heading toward... No, get the way Greenland towards Canada. Boom.
That's my perfect cousin and I, which sounds like a weird Jane Austen novel or something, I don't know, is clinging to the bottom of... whatever. No, your moon. Oh, that's not going to work. Is that, I'm clinging to your back like a weird version of Cape Fear, and you haven't noticed because you were so traumatized by the Bull and Churchill massacre that just happened. And I give you a wet willy in your ear so you fall over. But by which I mean the childhood thing. Like, let's get this completely straight. shouldn't need to clarify, but you know, feel I might as well.
So wait, your cousin's on my back, and you've just...
I'm on his back, and he's like, oh, well, right, you're the heavier one, and I'm like, shut up.
You're right, okay. Oh God, that is scary. Right, how do I deal with that situation? I'm currently in Canada. I ask Canadians to help me, and they do. they're so good at that.
You're too popular for this show, that's the problem. 1 minute left.
And I ride a moose over the ocean. I split my moon boots in half so there's four, and I gallop that dude right towards the Pacific?
Yeah, that's where you're going.
And then as far as I'm concerned, we get there.
Well, in the meantime, my cousin, who's been mauled by Canadians, lies wounded and twisted on the floor, and I lean in, and I'm like, oh my God, I'm so sorry that we feuded for so long, I need to help you, and he's like, you know, you could use that beer belly if you just switched to spirits, and I'm just like, ah, screw you. And just walk.
You got 10 seconds left, put on a show! Hey, well, okay, fine! Yeah, that'll work on radio! Wonderful stuff from both winners there in round two. Now, Tom, if you wouldn't mind leaving the stage, and if we could have Chella back on stage. It's time to find out the conclusion of this, a little bit racy. Your performance is a complete triumph. You really bring down the boat. No, seriously, it's sinking. You have to get off. Scrambling to the lifeboats, you realize you've learnt an important lesson about valuing your own survival over performance art. But on your way back to the shore, you're robbed at sword point by an audience member and thrown overboard. You take nervous solace in the desperate hope that this was actually all still part of the show. And it is you, our winner tonight. Let's decide now by way of applause, shall we? So, if you believe that Dave won, please cheer now. And if you think that it belongs to Chella, give her a big cheer. Dave again. One more for Chella. It is you, our winner tonight. Drum roll, please, everyone. David Anick. Well, that's all we got time for on this live show. I'd like to thank tonight's panelists, Pitt Mason, Chella Quint, David Anick and Tom Harrison. I've been your host, James Cottle, and I'm starting to suspect that this is not my AA meeting. See you next time!